I am very honored and happy to be in Israel and to be in this event of the Friedberg Economic Institute. For many decades, I have been a great, not only admirer, but even defender of the great epic of Israel. I live in airplanes, I travel around the world, I give conferences, so in many, many dinners and coffees, well, people discuss the Middle East, they discuss Israel. And in some countries, especially in Europe, you see some people speak with some antagonism or whatever to Israel. So I have been my honor to be very many times in a minority defending the epic of Israel and the great work that this country has done. And second, I have been for more than 30 years a friend, a good friend, of Albert and Nancy. We knew each other in Chile when Albert were one of the first people in the world to believe strongly in what we young free market economists were doing in Chile. And he visited me and we met precisely because he wanted to know the story that I will tell you, but he wanted it to know 30 years ago. And the good thing about Albert is that he does not only talk about what he believes, but he also invests in what he believes. So I hope, Albert, that that has been a good ride in Chile, as I know it has. And I have been honored to be at his home in Toronto many times. And we have dreamed about this idea of a think tank, of an education tank, really. So this dream is coming true today. And also with my friend Bob Borens, we have been friends for 20 years at the great Libertarian Cato Institute in Washington. And also Bob, of course, is passionate about his ideas and passionate about Jerusalem. So the fact that both my two greatest Israeli friends, whether Albert and Bob, are here together. And now I hope Corinne in the future. Now, the story I want to tell you is of a country that was destroyed by bad ideas and basically bad economic and social ideas. And that is my country, Chile, as you know, at the end of the world, as I know very well because I traveled 20 hours to be here with you in Jerusalem. A very long and very narrow country that for 200 years didn't find the right economic and social strategy for development. We are a country born of Spain. Now the kings of Spain, the monarchy of Spain was extremely centralized, bureaucratic, top-down, and they instilled in Chile and in all Latin America those values. Something very extraordinary is that 200, 300 years ago, the south of the Americas was the rich part of the world because we had great cities, we had gold. Well, people went to Latin America for gold, El Dorado. And we had these great cities of Mexico, of Lima, and the north was just some villages, New York, Boston. And after the great American Revolution, the American independence, a country born out of ideas of responsibility and freedom and rule of law, well, of course, America is the most successful economic country in the world, and Latin America has had 200 years of poverty, underdevelopment, political instabilities, dictatorships, caudillos, and so on. So the situation changed completely. You see, the north that was poor became incredibly rich and stable, and the south that was rich became incredibly poor and unstable. So when I went, I had my economics education in Chile. But in a place that was extraordinary. The key moment in Chile came in 1956 when a visionary dean of a university, of the University of Chicago in the U.S., and we have here Sam Pelsman who is of the University of Chicago. But this all begins with a dean, Theodore Schultz, who understands that the problem of Latin America is one of ideas. So he began looking for a country where Chicago University could enter into an agreement with the university to educate the people with the ideas of free markets and rule of law. In a way, I hope what the Friedberg Institute will do here in Israel. So Schultz finds the Catholic University of Chile in Santiago that is the right university. Other universities rejected him. You Americans, you gringos, you imperialists, why should we enter into an agreement with you? Well, the Catholic University, in an extraordinary thing, there was a good president of the university, agreed to make this Chicago Catholic University agreement. And the agreement basically was that Chicago University will send professors to the Chilean University. The best two students every year will go for graduate studies in Chicago, and they will be giving scholarships, free tuition, cappuccinos. I don't know whether I have cappuccinos in Chicago, probably not. But whatever, you see. And Chicago even gave a full library of liberty, because that Catholic University had a lot of writings of Spanish intellectuals, very status oriented. But the great works of Adam Smith, of John Locke, of Hayek, and of the Chicago professor were not there. So Chicago also sent, I don't remember, 10,000 books. So in Chile, we had this school. It was not a whole university. It was the School of Economics that became almost a fully owned subsidiary of Chicago University. And they began to train young people like you, without knowing exactly what would happen in the future. This was 1956. But we began creating then a critical mass of young people, economists, who understood the essence of the problem of Chile. And not only that, because there's a lot of people, experts on what is the problem, but what is the solution. We created a critical mass of, we call them free market economists. The press called them Chicago boys. I don't know the boys part. But the Chicago boys, you see, knew what was wrong and knew what had to be done eventually. And then history went on, and suddenly in Chile, because of this poverty and underdevelopment, the people have voted for the right, the center. They had never voted for a Marxist left until in 1970, out of desperation. A third of the country voted for the Marxist left. And regrettably, because the Chilean constitution was a bad one, someone with a third of the vote became president of Chile, President Salvador Allende, and tried to install in Chile a Marxist society, a communist dictatorship, very close to Cuba. Cuba had done that 40 years before by force. In this case, he was elected, even though with a third of the vote, but was elected democratically. So he wanted to make of Chile a second Cuba with a third of the votes. Now, regrettably, of course, he began the only way in a democracy to make a second Cuba is to violate the constitution, to stop the freedom of the press, to take over private companies. And then at some moment, the Chilean Congress that was still working said to Allende, you are violating the constitution. And even though you have been democratically elected, you have become a non-legitimate president. So the Chilean Congress, in a famous resolution of August 22, 1973, asked the armed forces to remove the man who had violated the Constitution of Chile. And then we had a very exceptional period that was inevitable, even though it was not, of course, the optimum, in which the armed forces had to remove a president who wanted to install a dictatorship in order to prevent that. And that was the, and a certain civil war followed that, and therefore there were people who fought in both sides. Very sad story of my country. But at that moment, something extraordinary happened. The government, in this case, people dress like military, but it's very similar when people dress like politicians. They had the power, but they didn't know what to do with power. Something that I have found all around the world. I have met some, maybe 50, 60, 70 presidents in the world. Once I was 4 hours with Vladimir Putin in his dacha outside Moscow. So among many, many others, Clinton, Bush, Prodi. And I am always impressed by how these people know how to reach power and know how to keep power and go to incredible extremes of intelligence of, in order to keep power, but generally they don't have a vision of what to do with power. It's amazing. And generally, the first thing I ask you, you have devoted 20 years of your life to reach the president of the country, for example. What do you want to do, sir? And the man looks at you very surprised, you see. They don't think that they have to do something with political power. Something beyond riding in the chauffeur car of the government and traveling in special planes and meeting in the G7, the G20, the G50, you see. But that doesn't change the life of the people. You have to do reforms with that political power that improves the lot of the country. So in Chile, what happened is that this emergency government didn't know. But the Chicago boys were there. This was an extraordinary thing. The Chicago boys, we agreed that this was an exceptional government, that we wanted a return to the rule of law, to democracy, to freedom. But in order to have that, you cannot simply stay outside and whatever, pray or criticize, but you have to enter an imperfect world with your principles. And I have always said that that is my motto, you see, a principled engagement in an imperfect world. The imperfect world part is because almost any government of the world is very imperfect. I have met all these presidents, and they all can be legitimately criticized. There are no saints as presidents or as leaders of countries. They are generally quite flawed individuals. And the system is quite flawed. But I do not believe in just criticizing them and having fun about them, something that can be done also, of course. I believe basically that if you can, in a given historic moment, of course, change the world by engaging those people, by transforming them and leading them into the right direction, you have to do it as long as you stay in a principled way and you don't become part of the very imperfect system. So, in 1975, 2 years after our crisis, the Chicago boys decided to enter as a team this government and basically take over in a friendly way, take over the economic and social policy of the country. And there we begin, and let me show you what happened after that. This is a quite extraordinary graph, Albert. Do you see well? Because we have calculated, incidentally, it was one professor of the Catholic University that is a friend of Sam Pelsman, Rolf Luders. Rolf Luders, who is a German guy, calculated the GNP of Chile since independence. Now, it's approximate, of course, but he spent 5 years reading books. I don't know how you calculate the GNP 200 years ago, but okay, they're Chicago boys. They can do everything. They are supermans. So Rolf Luders did the first part. He calculated since our independence, 1810, the GNP per capita, approximately. Yeah, but basically, this is the line. So we had 150 years, here is the Great Depression, but of very mediocre growth. So the story of the yellow line is a country that grows at average 2-3% a year. But since population grew at, let's say population grew at 2%, that meant growing income per capita at 1% a year. Well, when your income grows at 1% a year, that is, if you make 100, you make next year 101, you don't notice the change, and especially you cannot eliminate poverty and underdevelopment and the problems of health and education, you see. You are growing extremely slow, so it's not a matter of the bad or the good intentions of those who govern the country. In this period, we had all sorts of government. right, center, moderate, left, but they couldn't solve the problem because they had exactly the same economic strategy of state interventionism, protectionism, all the wrong economic policies. Some of them we learned last night in that very interesting dinner conference, you see, of how politicians apply wrong economic policy. So we have 150 years of wrong economic policy. So despite the natural wealth of Latin America, despite the people who are likely people, despite we were a mediocre country. And at the end of the day, that led to almost civil war and breakdown of democracy. And as some countries, for example, today in Europe are having that, you see, I briefly was in Spain last week. You see, they have unemployment of 55%, young unemployment. So I said, with young unemployment of 55%, you see, people will be killing themselves in the streets in a few years if that keeps that way, because that means desperation. Well, that's what we had in Chile. And then in the 70s, so here you have, well, 56, the Chicago Boys around here, 75 is the year when the crisis exploded economically. And the Chicago Boys came in. And the Chicago Boys applied a set of free market economic policies, not one or two. This has to be a radical process of coherent, transparent reforms, all connected one way with others, hopefully in the right sequence, if possible. And then look what happened. You see the red line there that looked like a rocket. It's not a rocket, it's the Chilean GNP per capita increase every year, because we were able to double the rate of growth of the country to 7%, more than double, for 20 years. Now, let me tell you an arithmetic point. When you grow at 7% a year for 10 years, your GNP doubles. 7% for 10 years, you double the size of your economy. And if you go for 20 years, you double and double. In other words, you multiply by 4. You see, that was the way it became. When I was 29 years, like some of you, I became Secretary of Labor because I was on television. I was basically a professor, but I was teaching in television. In other words, teaching to the country. And one of my students was the president of the country. That many years later, he told me that he saw me while he was in the bicycle, this gym bicycle. So he said, every day I was there in the bicycle, you see, and there you came, teaching basic ABC economics. And one of the things he always remembered was the, because I use fingers to make it, when I said, in 10 years, if you go at 7, you double the size. In 20 years, you multiply by 4. And then I went on, I said, if you multiply by 4 the size of your economy, well, that's it. That is a revolution. That is, revolution is not throwing Molotov bombs in the street, you see, and, or killing other people. That is not revolution. Revolution, in the good sense of the word, is to multiply by 4 the GNP of your country, therefore be able to solve the terrible problems that simple people may have in this underdeveloped country. So I was on television saying, now, in order to grow at 7% a year, well, we have to do these 10 reforms. But first, the goal cannot be let's move a little faster. No, let's change dramatically the size of the economy. So we were able to grow at 7% for more than 20 years. You see the rocket there going up. So Chile, from a GNP per capita of around $4,000, $4,000 and $5,000 in 75, we reach this year $20,000. And the World Bank, the IMF, says that around 23,000 is the threshold of development. So Chile is there to become the first Latin American developed country in history. We are there, 20,000, we will be 23, whatever happened. Generally, despite the current governments and despite the current politicians, we are there. We are becoming, we have become, that those numbers are very close already, the first developed country in Latin America. And and maybe one of the first developed countries in the emerging world in the last 30 years. Before us, the Asian tigers were able to do it. Singapore, those are great success stories there that, of course, we follow closely, but in a completely different cultural and so on, tradition and political and so on. But what is extraordinary is that a Latin country where people, you see, love to live the daily life like consumption, not savings, like a relaxed life, that is all is okay as long as you are able to solve the huge problems of underdevelopment. It's different to have a Latin life at $20,000 per capita. It's wonderful, but not at $4,000 per capita, where 50% of the population is poor, because at that moment, this is the key number. 50% of the Chilean population in 73, 75 were, according to some definitions, living in poverty. And there is no fun living in poverty in an underdeveloped country. You see, it means some of your children may die from health reasons, or it means that your children are not cannot be educated, or it means that you are so uneducated that you have a job where you cannot even discuss your wage, because simply you are almost a slave if you don't understand what you read well. You understand newspapers, you cannot find a job. You see, without a minimum level of health and education, you are not a free person. Even if you may vote every 4 years for whoever makes the best political campaign and offer more promises that he will not be able to keep and so on, you may vote every 4, every 5, and then you go to a life of quiet desperation. So we were able with this policy to diminish poverty from 50% to 11% of the population. So there is nothing more beautiful ethically and morally and to diminish poverty from 50 to 11. We still have 11%, and we have to diminish it hopefully to zero in the future, if we could. But that is hardcore poverty, people who simply have enormous difficulty in producing or in working or do not even want to work. Well, so you need more directed policies to those people, especially, in my view, always education, education, education. But 50 to 11. Now, what produced this? This is the key. What produced this clear success? There is no two opinions in the world that there has been a so-called, Milton Friedman called it the Chilean miracle. But there is no miracle. You see, I do believe in miracles, incidentally. Wasn't Ben Gurion who said, a man who does not believe in miracles is not a realistic man? I love that quote. So I do believe in miracles. But not in this field. You see, in this field, I believe in reforms. Well done, coherent, intelligent reforms. This is really not a miracle. So on that, I differ with my friend Milton. We were friends. This is not a miracle. This happened because of planning. This happened because of the 1956 Chicago-Chile agreement. This happened because there was a critical mass of economy. This happened because there's critical mass, instead of staying at American universities drinking cappuccinos or in Wall Street drinking champagne, they decided to enter an imperfect government in order to change it in the right direction. This happened because those people were not corrupted by power, as so many people are, and stayed making the reforms in the right direction. And this happened ultimately because once we returned to democracy, we were able to convince the adversary, and the adversary was able to take these economic policies and keep them for another 20 years. So a lot of things happened to make this possible. Now, the ultimate reason why we make this possible is because we increase dramatically the degree of liberty in the Chilean economy. In 1970, according to a famous ranking by the Fraser Institute, at that time they did it with 54 countries, and of 54 countries in economic liberty, the higher you are, the better, the number one is Hong Kong, always, of course, Hong Kong, and the number 54 is Chile, you understand, 54-54. That means the last one. Imagine in soccer to be 54 or 54. Israel, right? I didn't apply to Israel, because of respect. Because imagine that Israel were 51, I wouldn't feel well. So I, when I go to a country, I prefer not to, unless it is Hong Kong. But I did look on Congo. I have nothing against Congo, you see. But Congo was above Chile. So no surprise that we had a certain problems here, you see. And Chile was behind the Congo. Economics. And yet we voted every 4 years. We thought that we were very free because we went with a piece of paper and choose among four demagogues, you see, the least bad. But then nothing happened. You went home to a life of poverty. 54. Well, this is extraordinary. 40 years later, this rankings now cover 177 countries. They do it with people, with think tanks in each country. I don't know who is in Israel the counterpart. Are you? Ah, okay. So you are the counterpart of the, yes. The Fraser has in each country a counterpart. And they study something like 45 variables, if I am not wrong, to make this rank. 45 variables. It's very well done. And they check it in the, well, in 2000, Chile is number 7 in the world. And I like to tease my American friends. They are number 8. Now, 57 and 8 is the same. So I grant them, to my, we are the same. But we are with the founding fathers there, you see, with Thomas Jefferson. So how can we be proud? This is a ranking that we Chileans do not manage. Raise the region. Number 7. The U.S. number 8. And I always say to my friends at Fraser that they have some historic wrong because Hong Kong is not any longer a country, you know. So if the Chinese look at this, they may be angry with the Fraser Institute because Hong Kong is a province or whatever, special. So you should take out Hong Kong. And Chile then goes from number 7 to, Corinne? Number 6! So the, and number 2, incidentally, is Singapore. Now, Singapore is a country. I'm a great admirer of Lee Kuan Yew. But still, it's a city. No, but I will not take out Singapore. But if I wanted, I take out Singapore, and then we go to number 5. We are approaching heaven, you see. But anyway, a lot of people have done econometric. Yes, I didn't finish that. I finally studied my Chicago economics. I did very well, so I was offered that great scholarship to Chicago, to free tuition, cappuccinos, an old Volkswagen. And I took my first act of rebellion in life. I said, no, I have had already 4 years of Chicago because the Chilean Chicago professors were so lazy that they photocopied the reading list of Sam Pelsman or Stigler. They photocopied the test. No, honestly, it was Chicago all the way, with warm weather in Chile and not with wind and terrible winters. So I didn't want to go to Chicago for my PhD because I said I already have Chicago. Why should I have more Chicago? I went to Harvard University. That's another very good more humanistic, because I always wanted to change the world, and if you want to change the world, you cannot be only an economist. I do believe you need to know about history, about political science, even about literature, and even about poetry, because you will have to sell this, explain this to the people, and all those things are useful in life. So I went for my master's and my PhD at Harvard University. I am very proud. So in Chile, they joke with me, they call me a Chicago boy and a Harvard man. But I am very proud of both. But anyway, what I was telling the story is that a lot of economists in Harvard and Chicago have made a correlation, you see, between economic freedom and economic GNP. So Chile is still not the number 7 country in the world, it's number 40 with that 20,000. But if we keep this, you see, Chile will begin going up in that ranking because there is, in the long term, not next year, a clear correlation between economic freedom and... Now, here we come to the... Because when I met the Chilean president and the Chilean elite and so on, you see, the other thing is the easy thing. You see, if you grow, it's great, it's paradise, it's okay.
But this is the tough part where you say, okay, if you want to reach that, it's not just talk. You have to do reforms. And I showed them, initially on television, and then to the president of the country, okay, if you want to reach heaven, paradise, whatever the name, you have to do this. And this is not easy. So the first thing I want to immediately tell you, please don't tell me it cannot be done. As Bob Boris beautifully said yesterday, in a country like Israel that has done the impossible by existing, nobody should be allowed to say it cannot be done. You see, maybe there should be a law prohibiting Israelis to say it cannot be done. See, let's have all of Europe saying it cannot be done. When I do this, immediately the people rise in the room and say it cannot be done. Wonderful, but it cannot be done. Well, I am a testimony that these things can be done because we have done it. When I meet a president, the first thing I tell him is not that I am a Harvard PhD. There are thousands of Harvard PhDs, and Chicago PhD is very good. I tell them I have done it. And then they open the eyes and offer me the first cappuccino. Before that, they offer me just water, you see. So I will go fast, but in the question and answer, of course, all is very... pension reform. Well, I did a huge pension reform. Instead of having the state managing pension through what is called the pay-as-you-go system. The pay-as-you-go system was invented by, to me, an incredibly wrong person called Chancellor Otto von Bismarck, a Prussian chancellor, who was a conservative, very conservative, who wanted to buy the other side, see, many of them, by giving to the other side something, and he created the state pension system. In his memoirs, he went even further. He said, I wanted to unify Germany, and as we know, by blood and military, and for that I needed obedient soldiers, and any man whose pension depends on the state is an obedient man. So he understood it. You see, if your life depends on the state, you kind of are obedient, you're servile, and he even was proud of. And he created the militaristic Germany that we know what horrible thing they did in the 20th century. But anyway, he created people servile to the government. And the biggest Bismarck reform was the creation of the what I call the Bismarckian pension system. You tax the workers, the money goes into a black hole that is the government social security or pension system, and the government pays the pension. So the people are grateful to the government, to the politicians. A lot of people believe that the pensions come from the politicians' goodwill. So you create a cultural, a political, a psychological relation extremely dangerous to a free society. And not only that, but that system also goes bankrupt because of demographic reasons. People have less children, regrettably, and thankfully, doctors are increasing our expectancy of life. So each time there are less workers financing the old people are living longer and longer lives. So all this combined to make of the old pension system a disaster. So I decided that was my main reform, to change completely, radically the structure. I didn't say we will just make cosmetic changes, increase a little the retirement age. You keep the same flow. And I did the pension reform, and I will go later into that. That is the star reform of Chile. But the second one that's very important, we were a protectionist country, and we're a small country. We could not produce everything, and we tried at that time to produce cars and refrigerators. We said, let's open to imports. Yesterday was explained very well. People like iPads and like good cars, Koreans or whatever, and we export. And we have enormous comparative advantage in exporting a lot of things. We export copper, salmon, agriculture, et cetera, et cetera. So we went toward free trade. Albert was remembering when the industrialists in Chile, the entrepreneurs, came to us, the Chicago boys, saying, no, this will be a disaster. We are producing bad televisions, but we are at the end of the day producing a television. And we said, no, you are being subsidized by government. If you can do it and compete with the Koreans, do it. So we brought down tariffs from an average of 300% to 10% flat in 5 years. And now we are at almost 0%. Also in agriculture, I heard yesterday that Israel is extremely protecting agriculture and food is expensive, and therefore the poor people who spend a fraction, a high fraction in poor, that is, I would call that a policy against the poor. I will brand it as a policy against the poor. But because of course it is, the food. No, we have free trade in food, and therefore food is very cheap, and whatever. And deregulation, of course, we had thousands of prices. So then we privatized all the state-owned companies. We said the government has a role, but that role has been defined by the founding fathers of America. You see, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And that means the judiciary, the military, the safety net, and a few other things, but not to produce telecommunications and electricity and steel and iron and what. So in a very transparent and honest process, completely different from what the Soviet Union, what Russia did, we privatized state-owned companies that have increased enormously in efficiency and have increased productivity in Chile, allowing us to grow at 7%, because you grow 7% when each company, small, medium, and high, are extremely productive and extremely efficient. And for that, of course, you need incentives, and of course, you need private ownership. You see, it's impossible to have a high productivity with a state-owned company, whatever the good intentions of the managers. Then, and something that Albert was always a great supporter, I did a deep trade union reform. You see, I believe in the freedom of association. Of course, I believe in someone could have a union, but I do not believe in monopoly unions, and I don't believe in the state protecting monopoly unions and protecting a strike that destroy the power of the entrepreneur to manage his company. So yesterday I heard that you have a lot of strikes here in Israel. You see, we created a trade union law that was completely different from the old. We have collective bargaining at the company level. We define that collective bargaining is a process where both sides look at the specific productivity gains of the workers, and that can only be assessed really at the company level, because specific productivity is something that comes from a group of people working in a company, and they produce something a little more than the market wage, and therefore to find that wage you have a collective bargaining. And therefore, if they do not reach agreement after 60 days, we have a very good regulated process, the union can say, okay, we will not work, because you are not paying what we believe we are worth. But during that period, of course, the entrepreneur can manage his company if he can, with his brothers, his sisters, his family, his friends, whoever. If he owns the premises, if he has, for example, fruit there, he has the right to put the fruit in the trucks to go to the ports. Otherwise, the strike becomes a chantage, basically, and you are not. So we did a strike as a way of showing the productivity of the worker, but not as a way of damaging the other side. There are two completely different ways. So if you have a strike regulated in the law, as most countries in the world, not to mention the French and the Spanish, as a way to damage society, to damage the economy, then you are getting wages according to your power of damaging. And that has nothing to do with productivity or with efficiency or with fairness. But if you have a strike only as a way of showing the other side that we are valuable, so I will abandon you for a week so much so that you see how much I am valued, well, that is different. But anyway, since we have regulated it in the framework of a free market economy and at the company level, we almost don't have strikes, because workers understand that if they strike in a textile company in Chile and all the other textile companies are working and you have imports of textile, very soon you may bankrupt your company. So I do remember the first strikes under my law, the unions and the entrepreneurs came to me and said, look, there is a strike, you have to do something, you are the Minister of Labor. I said, on the contrary, I am the Minister of Labor, I set the rules, but now you bargain. And if you go bankrupt, I will be very sorry, I will pray for you at night, but you will not have a dime from the government, because if you are irrational, both sides, and destroy your company, why should I say something? On the contrary, I may even put a tax on you, on your personal holdings, for irrational. So don't come here. So we close the doors,
of the ministry. Nobody can come here. Once the law is fair, you agree. I said, husbands and wife discuss. Should the government go into a husband and wife discussion? The employer and the worker discuss how much the value of the worker. Make an agreement. But as long as you know that no politician, no minister, no government will come in, you have an incentive to agree. But if you believe that the government will come, you both have an incentive to disagree and extreme your positions and try to get the politicians into the strike. And sometimes the entrepreneurs have more power because they finance the campaigns of the politicians. Sometimes the workers have more power if they are too many or they are in a crucial sector of the economy. So it depends. But the point is that the politicians do not enter collective bargaining or strikes in Chile at all. So we don't have strikes because generally people don't find that way to reach agreement. They better think which is the right wage. And that has opened the way for full employment. We have now full employment in Chile, 6%. And also we have taken out from the politicized central unions the power to block good policy measures. I believe that monopolistic unions have two huge costs to the economy. One is the direct economic cost of stopping an activity for whatever they want. And in an export economy like Chile, that is another. You see, someone may be exporting salmon to Japan, and you have this Japanese supermarkets waiting for the salmon, and you develop a 10-year relationship to sell them at the best price at the right time. If you have a strike at the salmon plant and you don't comply with the Japanese supermarket, you lost 10 years of a relationship, of a marketing campaign, of brand. So the cost of disrupting. I am always amazed in Europe. I almost don't fly European airlines, even though they are Air France, Lufthansa. But they can strike any day at any moment. They have what they call wild strike. They simply decide 2 days before that they will strike. And millions of people who have dreamed with a trip to Paris or whatever suddenly cannot fly. That, to me, that is chantage. That is not labor rights at all. See, they damage other people in order to get something. So this is a completely, of course, new way of looking at it. Well, we had enormous natural resources in Chile. This president Allende nationalize oil copper in Chile, not only nationalize, put it in the constitution that the state owns all the mines, all the oil, everything, and nobody can do it except the state. Now, of course, we know that bureaucrats of the state never find mines. I asked one of my students to look for 100 years when a mine had been found by a bureaucrat, and he found that zero. And someone told me, look, maybe there was one 40 years ago who found something, but of course he resigned his government post, and 3 months later he claimed the mine to himself. Of course. So never a government bureaucrat has found a mine, or shale gas, as you're finding, I understand, in Israel, or gas, or whatever. No, that has to be private sector under the rules, of course, under wise, rational, balance rules. So I had also, I was after labor minister of mining because copper is the key commodity of Chile, and I had to overturn completely the nationalization of copper by opening the mining sector. I created a strong lease. I couldn't change the constitution. So the state owned the mines, but the private sector owned the lease. So basically with that, I found a way for billions of dollars to come into Chilean mining, and Chile is a mining country. So we were producing 1 million tons of copper when I was minister of mining. Now we produce 6 million tons. And the price was $1 a pound. Thanks to China and Deng Xiaoping, the price is $3. So now we receive 6 multiplied by 3, 18 times the foreign exchange that we were producing. That's why we can import a lot of things, because with copper we buy cars, you see. And now any worker, any gardener, even minimum wage workers in Chile have a used car. Everyone can have a car. Now, of course, we have roads, but then we price all roads in Chile. In Chile, nobody has free parking, as yesterday was saying. You enter a road, you enter a street, you pay for a scarce resource. But anyone can do it in an emergency or if they choose to. Then we open education to private sector, of course. at every level, we implemented basically Milton Friedman voucher scheme. And even though in America, I am told 10% of primary and secondary education is private, 10%. In Chile, we have gone to 65%. In Chile, it was also 10%, 90% was government education. And with the vouchers, the parents, not the government, choose for their children private education. And the government pay the parents a voucher, and they go to a private school and put the voucher. So now 65% of Chilean parents choose private education. And each year increasing, we are going toward 80%. The government schools, of course, are more in the rural sectors. In Santiago, it is something like 80% is private. So we are moving toward private education, and I strongly believe in private education. You see, I am even more in favor of private education than private steel. At the end of the day, even some governments can produce steel, a commodity, is quite similar to private, much costly in a government state-owned company. But education, framing the mind, the culture, the values of the young people should never be produced by the government, because government is force, as General Washington said, not eloquence, it's not persuasion, it's force, and it's politicized, and there are parties, and there are people with their own agenda. So how can we send our children, 5 years old, 8 years old, to people, professors, who regrettably are influenced, even though they may be heroes or maybe good people, but they are influenced by the government culture, by the government culture of strikes, by the government culture of statism, and so on. So this is a very long-term, also important thing. Well, we open on also private health options. We focus the government money on poverty elimination. So we stop a lot of subsidies to everything that we had in our country, precisely because of FESET group. And we said, okay, the government has to give opportunities to the poor. I am all for that, for a safety net. I do believe that for whatever reason, some people are very disadvantaged. And if we want equality of opportunity, or approaching equality of opportunity, we must help them some way or another with health and education, nutrition. To me, those are the key elements. And we focus then, the point there is to be courageous in government, and we had to do it, and cut the subsidy to the private sector, to the banking industry, you see, to all those powerful. In Europe, all the media is subsidized by the government. There are enormous subsidies. In America, ethanol, whatever, corporate welfare is called by Cato Institute, billions of dollars. We went all against subsidizing the private sector. And I remember I went on television in Chile, and I have a lot of friends in the private sector, and I said, precisely because we love you and we believe in you and we believe you are so efficient, we are cutting your subsidy. You're so good. You don't need these crutches. You should be ashamed of having had these subsidies for 50 years. We will not take it back, but from now on, zero, because you're efficient. You're private sector. So no subsidies. And with that, we dedicated that money to nutrition at early age. A key element, you see, if your brain doesn't have enough food and irrigation and whatever in the first year, 2 years, 3 years, then you are enormously disadvantaged in life. So the very poor, we should help them to reach the moment where they can benefit from the enormous possibilities of a free market economy. So we focus that, and that's why we went from 50 to 11. You see, focusing on the very poor like a laser beam. Well, of course, we created an independent central bank. In Latin America, that was a huge problem, that politicians managed the money supply. So we put, I know there's a debate, there can be other ways to do it, but the way we could do it was to create a central bank completely independent of the government, and we prohibited in the constitution that central bank to lend money to the Minister of Finance. That is, the Minister of Finance, first of all, should spend only what he has. But if there is an emergency, he may issue a bond approved by Congress, but he cannot command the independent central bank to lend him money. And this has worked very well, and we have now 2% inflation for the last 30 years. Countries that have 30, 50, 100%, we Latin America are the land of inflation.
And finally, and now in the last 5 years, you see the pension funds have accumulated so much money, they can invest in Chile and abroad. But we have found that another way of diminishing fiscal expenditure and dedicating it more to the poor or reducing taxes is to allow the private sector to build almost all the infrastructure of Chile according to some rules, of course. So for the pension, you see, the way it works is that, of course, there is an infrastructure ministry that, let's say, plans the way of a good road between Jerusalem and Tel Aviv, five highways on each side, even arriving to Jerusalem, not going to three or two at the bottleneck, but no, five all the way. So that cost $1 billion. So a private company who knows how to build can. Now they don't have the $1 billion, they issue long-term bonds because a highway is paid in 20, 30 years. They issue long-term bonds at the market rate, the pension fund buys them. And then the car owner pays $1 or $2 to go from Jerusalem to Tel Aviv, you see, in 20 minutes, knowing exactly that there cannot be a gridlock because in a five highway way, you don't have a gridlock. So you know you will arrive and you pay $3 for that. And I am extreme, I would pay much more, really, for not to be in gridlocks around the world. I cannot believe in LA, they always say the problem of traffic in LA. You see, one of the most successful cities in the world, but they don't have toll roads, or they don't have the... Even the great Hollywood actors have to stay in line there for hours in order to reach the Hollywood studios because they don't have toll roads in Jerusalem, in LA. It's nonsense. You see, you have to pay. So that is the way it is financed and built. And in some of these very good roads in Chile, there are signs in the roads that are very beautiful because the signs says this. I am exaggerating, of course, let's say three ways on each side, highway, is financed by your pension money. And you will pay a toll soon of $2, and that toll will pay the interest of the bonds that help finance that, and it will go to your pension fund and will pay your pension benefit. So you're going on a highway because of your pension funds, and the toll you are paying will pay your pension. It's economics in a tweet. You are all in Twitter, I hope. It's very important to be able to write in 140 characters. So it works perfectly. And now we're building the airports in that way and the ports in that way. So why should we invest in airports that are generally employed by the middle class or the high class? You see, why the poor person should know? All those things should be built and operated by the private sector in this way in which you charge the actual price. So those are the 10 reforms. Now, this is the White House called the pension. This was Clinton very happy after. So his chief of staff wrote me a letter and said, your pension reform is the mother of all reforms. Someday we will do it in the US. We were very close to doing it with Clinton. But he got distracted, as we all know, at some moment. He, extremely distracted. You either change the world or have fun in the Oval Office, but you cannot do both. It's obvious. It's morally obvious. But so we didn't do it. The results in Chile, we had a pension debt of 100% when we did it. Now the pension debt has gone down to 6%. That is the people who are receiving government pensions. And since they are going slowly to meet their creator, This is going to zero, and the finance minister is happy about that, not because of the people going away, but because of the fact that he will not have any pension payment, because the new pensions are being paid by the new 60. Look at the US, 100% unfunded liability of pension debt, Europe 300%. So we have capital in Chile of 80% of GDP in these private funds that can invest in infrastructure, in salmon, in mining, and more very important, we have a country of worker capital, because I am very proud of the fact that we have solved the pension problem, but at the same time made every worker a small capitalist, an owner of capital. Every worker has this money in their account, that money is invested in the economy, so the incentives are right. I believe so strongly in the right incentive. These worker capitalist incentives are aligned with the economy. They don't want inflation, they don't want high taxes. High taxes reduce the value of companies. They want free trade because free trade increased the GNP of the country. So when we entered the free trade agreement with the US, even though we had a left,
that disliked the U.S., but they also understood that a free trade with the U.S. increased exports and the value of all companies and therefore the value of their own pension funds. So we played that ideology against results, but incentives, see? Now, very fast, this is the man who created the whole system. I wouldn't like to find him at night, you see, in the street. This is the Chilean system. In a nutshell, we can go, every worker has a personal retirement account. At retirement, you either have a life annuity, the system is managed by the private sector, the role of government is supervision, safety net. That is a David, incidentally, of course. Huh? King David in Firenze. I like that eyes, because those are, we were fighting Goliath in Chile, Goliath being the state. Huh? So this will be the cover of my book about this. Of course, it's David. And I am, and thanks to Albert, I am at the King David Hotel. So maybe I should write the, maybe you should put me at that hotel to finish my book, Albert. I may make a note there. Now, there is something called the transition challenge. You are too far to worry about that, but we have to go from one system to the other. That is extremely difficult. Okay, nobody even told me, please, this is difficult. You see, the easy things I all give them to my children. You see, I always specialize in extremely difficult things. That is the fun of it. This is difficult, but can be done. Now, you have to keep the promises to the old people. You will not kill them and so on. Or you will not tell them, Bismarck was wrong, I am taking away your pension. Of course not. We gave something very interesting. Greenspan was very interesting, the fact that we created a recognition bond to recognize the past contributions of someone. So when I gave every worker in Chile the option of staying in the Bismarckian system with all the risk and with Bismarck portrayed in their bedrooms, or to come to the new system, I gave them a recognition of their past contributions. And see, they didn't have the money, of course. We created a zero coupon bond that paid all the money at retirement, called the recognition bond. So every worker went from the old system to the new one with the recognition bond. So someone who is 50 years old can go to the new system, put the recognition bond in the account, make savings for another 15 years, and then he will have both the new savings and the recognition bond. The 20-year-old doesn't have a recognition bond, he's entering the labor force. So the old new system, new entrance to the labor force has to go into the new system. So we gave all the workers in the system the option. This is the silver bullet politically, you see, because you can tell the people, look, if you don't like this crazy Piñera idea, don't go for it. Stay in the old system with Bismarck in your bedroom. But if you like it, you can go and we recognize your own. So it's a free choice. 90% of Chileans move to the new system. 90%. So we have 10% of Chileans who are genetically communist, don't like capital, don't like to have pension funds. I respect them as long as they do not impose on the other 90%. So 90% at that time, no, now it's 99%. Incidentally, even the president of Chile doesn't have a special pension. The president of Chile has also a little private account. And when she retires, she will look at the account and see whether she can have a good pension. Nothing special for the president, nor for the senators, nor for the, no, everyone is in the system. Now, the transition financing is a big different business, but the key was to educate the system, to use the media, to keep it simple. The results, never a peso has been lost in the system. The rate of return that I expect to the country could be maybe 4% above inflation for 30 years. That is more or less what a good portfolio could give in a very balanced way and prudent way. Well, thanks to the fact that we did it in a moment of growth and we privatized the state companies after we did the pension fund, so all the upside of the stock of the privatized company went to the workers and to people who had invested visionary at the very beginning, the funds had given almost 9% above inflation for 33 years. You see, it's an extraordinary rate of return to the workers. This has been massive gains by the workers of mining their pension funds. We have total fiscal solvency, and the pillars of the system have been kept intact for 6 governments. And even the Lehman Brothers crisis, of course, the value of funds go down 10% in the Lehman Brothers. I go to TV, I said, okay, this year 10%, but it's not the end of capitalism. has even won Nobel Prize. Joseph Stiglitz is this guy. You see, now they are giving away the Nobel Prizes to anyone. So this guy Stiglitz said, you see, because Lehman Brothers went bankrupt, this is the end of capitalism. You remember that? That was the headline in all the world, not America, who doesn't take this guy seriously. Well, we didn't believe it was the end of the world, so the pension funds even invested more at the bottom of that, and today they are the historic maximums. Because capitalism is healthy, strong all over the world. I visit China, I visit India, I visit Vietnam, Indonesia. It's about capitalism. Capitalism with a human face, with safety nets, with investment in health and nutrition of the poor, of course. But at the end of the day, it's freedom. Free markets are winning the day all over the world. Except in North Korea and Cuba, you see, but those are sort of Disneyland parks, you see, just to visit them. But nobody wants to live there. Something incredible that came recently is that if a worker in Chile has $100 in the account, $73 of the $100, $73 are from the profitability, from the fact that we have allowed a system of accumulation, from the fact that compound interest is the most powerful force in universe. It's interest over interest. So if someone has 100, 73 are given by the markets. And 27 are his monthly contribution. This is extraordinary. So I dedicate my life now to expand this idea. The red countries are where I have been able to convince presidents and governments to do it. Very proud of having done this in Peru, that is booming now, a country that was also even more poor than Chile. And Peru is growing at 6-7% a year. Then Colombia is another one who has had a 50-year civil war, partly because of poverty also, and now is also booming, and I'm very... And then Mexico, the neighbor of the U.S., there are 50 million Mexicans with a Chilean personal retirement account building capital for their future. So these four countries in the Pacific are doing very well, among other reasons, because they have these savings and so on. And there are others in Latin America also with the system. And then I went to Central Eastern Europe after the fall of the Berlin Wall, and we convinced Poland, Slovakia, Kazakhstan, Lithuania, and so on to begin, but they all began very small systems. They are all mixed systems, and I don't believe in mixing systems. My doctor knows that when I will develop cancer, hope not, he will remove all the cancer. I never tell him to do a mixed solution there, to remove only half. You see, I told him, if I have cancer, please remove all the cancer. I do believe the Bismarck system is a cancer on the economy, so I do believe you should go with the full solution. These four countries have done the full solution and the system is working very well. Regrettably, my friends in Central Eastern Europe, they have taken my idea to middle way. Well, if you go middle way, you get middle way results. So some of those countries are regrettably going back. Hungary, for example, they have a populist, rightist Prime Minister Orban, and Prime Minister Orban, in order to have money to win elections and win elections, is getting his hands into the private pension fund because it's very attractive. And regrettably, they don't have a constitution that protects them strongly as we do have in Chile. So that is my story of a dream come true. Not everything is perfect. We still in Chile, of course, have problems. A lot of them, the problems of development. You see, now we are having energy scarcity because everyone has a TV, everyone. So we need more energy. So there's a little energy crisis. We have not been willing to go to nuclear energy because of environmental concerns. So we do have a discussion on energy. We are not the Chicago Boys in charge any longer. But you can debate that and solve that. We have congestion because so many cars, of course, at the end of the day, even if you pay for the highways, it's very difficult to have payment inside the cities, even though it can be done. We are pushing for that. But anyway, we still have congestion. So please, I don't want to tell you of a country without problem. No, every country has problems. But the problems of development, the problems of $20,000 per capita are not the problem of your children dying because of health reasons or being uneducated and so on. So I am strongly in favor of fast growth, development, elimination of poverty, and all this creating a free country. So if any of these ideas can be of help to you, not today, you are young people, but eventually you will have the same opportunity I had at 29, 30 years old to go into government, not necessarily at the secretary level. You can go at another age. We were fortunate at the moment to be able to take control at the highest level, but you can help your country at other levels. And the important thing is to believe that ideas have enormous power, if well explained, and that to do the correct thing in life is the best politics at all. You see, the good way to do things is to do what is correct, to sleep well, to have a clean conscience, and to wait for the results. You will not always have the results immediately. You may have to wait for a good prime minister to work with another 5, another 10, another 15, another 20 years. We don't control that. Our role as reformers and you is to plant the seed of something that is correct, to care for it, to water it with care, to visit again. I visit each country where I grow, but you never know when it will blossom and it will result. But it can be done, and that should be my main lesson. So thank you very much, and I am open to any question. Questions here? Yes. Direct.
I noticed that you had Egypt on your map. I wanted to ask how economic reforms happen while there's political revolution going on.
No, Egypt, during Mubarak's times, there were some young economists whom I had convinced about that, and the Mubarak parliament approved a system like this, very small, to begin in the future, and then he fell down the Egyptian revolution. So to be correct, I will tell my webmaster in 5 minutes to take out the red out of Egypt. No, and I don't believe now there is any chance in Egypt. So I didn't even go myself. It was a young group who came to Chile, of economists in the government, and I convinced them I am not responsible, and they got a law there, but the law was never implemented in it. And I knew it would be very difficult. So thank you for pointing that out, because that is not updated.
Too bad,
but that is the way it is. Yes, of course.
How do you view the role of the philanthropic sector?
Of the
philanthropic sector.
Excellent question. Well, I am all for it. You see, I am. We don't have a philanthropic tradition in Chile, regrettably. You see, well, because everyone thought the state is in charge. So our elites, our rich people, have never had a philanthropic. Well, there are exceptions. Let me say there are always exceptions, but there is not. So I am on the record in Chile. Strongly, of course, I am for lower taxes, personal and corporate taxes, and say, but at the same time, there should be easy ways to give money to all sort of philanthropic things, and that should be the future. And a lot of my friends, you see, who had a company who was valued $100 million, because of all this, that company today is valued at $1,000 million. There are a lot of new rich people in Chile, because they are talented, but also because they had the right assets when we did this free market economy. So I told them, but that is not as a reformer, as a friend of them. I believe you should be strongly philanthropic. I am all for people giving away money, you see, to good causes, not imposed by the government, but by their own moral sense. So that is a challenge for the future. For example, it's very difficult to give money in Chile today because, regrettably, we have this Internal Revenue Service that in Chile, before you give money, the Internal Revenue Service want to know exactly where you got the money, how. They review 10 years of your taxes. So a lot of friends of mine who would like to give money, but they don't want the Internal Revenue Service looking for 10 years because you may have a little sin somewhere or you may have something done wrong. So you want to give $100 million that a lot of my friends could give, but Internal Revenue Service will first come and look at you. And all over the world, people don't prefer not to have it. So, for example, I have proposed that anyone who gives money should not be reviewed. Now, then the state says, that what about if he is a drug lord? Well, I said, if he's a drug lord and now he's giving away his money to the poor, thank God. You see, find the drug lord at the source. But I don't care if the cartel de Medellin, you see, gives money to the poor. But again, you have to change the switch in our country. No, we want to know exactly where all this thing in the West, you see, about going after the origin of the money and the so-called black money, all this is leading to police states in the tax revenue side. I am totally against that. So, but it's a very good point, so we have to work more. And I'm so happy here that we have philanthropists like my friend Albert, for example. He has the best, maybe he has not told you, but he has the best school in, he has created a school in Chile, the Maimonides School. Have you told that? This audience probably no. See, the Maimonides School in Chile, created by my dear friend Albert. Excuse me, Albert, I am hurting your humility. You are a humble puppet. But that's the way it is. And that school in 10 years is already at the top of the schools in Chile, totally financed by Albert. And every Jewish family in Chile who wants to send their children to a good school, send them to the Maimonides School. See, that is changing a country. In the future, you see all those young people, probably very well educated at home, will be a force for good in my country. So those things are, no, I am all for it. I even tell my friends, you see, there is this thing, well, the economists, it's called the declining marginal utility of money. You see, after all, after five cappuccinos, you cannot have a sixth cappuccino. To put it simply, see, while you can give money and be happy by creating good forever, so psychologically you can derive enormous happiness from giving away. While from consumption, you cannot go too far. After all, you cannot have 10 dinners at night. Now, I would like sometimes a private jet, you see, but instead of flying all night cramped there from Chile. But okay, I prefer not to sell my soul for a private jet that I have been offered by the big insurance companies of the world, Allianz. I know you want to fly private, but say a good word about us. I prefer not, because that way I can be more effective as a reformer, and I can, well, come on, I'm joking. But I am all for what you say, sir. Yes?
Two questions that are intertwined. On one of your original drafts, you had that in 1975.
How can I go to my draft? Ah, here. Okay.
With the GNP graph, the second slide.
Okay, some good person do it. I don't do this.
Go to the second.
Okay, but make the question. Fast and go. Let's go.
So the in 1981 to about 83, what it seemed, there's the next slide.
Okay, but make the question.
I'm sorry.
You
so,
can leave without breath.
The GNP dropped almost the same amount of drop in 75. I'm curious why that happened.
Ah, no, that was 82 in Chile. In Latin America, there was a huge crisis when Mexico stopped paying the debt. And all our countries depended at that moment on foreign capital. So Mexico defaulted, so the big banks of the world stopped all lending to all Latin American countries, and we in Chile, since we were going up, everywhere was very much in debt, in the good sense of the word. But they took out from us, because remember that at that time, the banks saw Latin America as one big region. They didn't distinguish that Chile was doing this, because Chile still. So we had a huge stop of the inflow of capital. We were hugely penalized. And then because one finance minister in Chile made a mistake, following one Chicago professor, incidentally, and fixed the exchange rate. You see, economists, you see, I am for flexible exchange rate. Again, I am with Milton Friedman on that. But there was some moment a theory that if you fix the exchange rate, you can bring down inflation very fast, and therefore blah, blah, blah. And this finance minister, a Chicago boy, incidentally, but a dogmatic one, fixed the exchange rate in a country with a lot of rigidities in order to try to bring an increase in the exchange rate by what is called today internal devaluation. It's extremely difficult in a Latin country because you have to decrease nominal wages. So I oppose him on that very strongly, with the support of Friedman, incidentally. So the two things were combined, a foreign crisis and a technical huge mistake. And now the good thing is that can never happen again, and that was Lehman Brothers didn't impact Chile, because Lehman Brothers was stopped the flow of capital to a lot of emerging countries, but we had 200 billions of internal money in Chile. And the Chilean pension fund knew that the Chilean economy was not going bust because some guy in Lehman Brothers had leveraged himself to death, you see, whatever. So we now do not depend on foreign flows of money. That is important, you see. That may be even important for Israel. I am stepping my bounds here, but
I understand you do receive a lot of foreign money, and some of those people who give you money also want you to have your security policies this way or that other way, and the security policies are extremely important for you, as of course. So I don't see why you should follow, you see, my friend Kerry, you see, security policies. Kerry may know a lot about Boston and whatever, but not necessarily about the security needs of Israel. So I wouldn't be pushed around by Kerry. I'm here. I know him. But if he were to threaten, you see, stopping in credit flows and money, if you had huge pension funds inside Israel, because of, if you do my reform, you will have a lot of Israeli money inside Israel, or outside, by being called by you. And then you will be even more independent in your foreign and your security policy. But I am going beyond. I know something about that, but I don't comment because I know my limitations. Another question. Yes, the lady?
I was wondering if you could speak more about healthcare. I understand that taking it away from the government portfolio reduces like a tax burden, but what impact does it have on how much people end up spending on healthcare themselves?
Yes, that is a very interesting question. Now, my answer generally is that healthcare, a huge reform in healthcare generally should come after the pension reform. So generally I say, do first the pension reform, invite me again to Israel, to the King David, and I give you the health reform. Because otherwise your head will go a little too cold. But that's my general answer. Now, for a student, I would go a little further. We have a mixed system in Chile. We allow the workers pay a given contribution to health, as in America. But the difference is that the worker can use that contribution to buy a plan in the private sector, has a minimum, but can buy a health insurance in the private sector. In that case, the government doesn't have to care for you. There is a huge new private sector in medical in Chile. And then we keep another big part, and on that I am in favor, because in principle, the very poor do not, contribution as a percentage of the wage of the very poor do not allow them to buy a plan good enough in the private sector. So they are taken care basically by a government system. But as income per capita goes up, the contribution, that is a fixed rate, 7% of wage. 7% of $1,000 is $70 a month, and with $70 a month you buy a wonderful health plan in the private sector. Very good for you and your family. But if you make half that, 7% of half of that is $35, and regrettably with $35 you do not buy. So as income per capita goes up, we are moving people, that they are moving to the private sector in health. And in that way, the incentives are right. I am very critical of the health system of the US, Medicare, Medicaid. The government basically gives free health, basically. And that means that a lot of people who are not sick go to the doctors. Fake disability, for example, disability rates in the West have gone up. No, because, of course, if you fake, you see a strong pain here, so I will stop my conference after, because strong pain and give me a check also. And a doctor, you don't know exactly. So disability has tripled in the West. Fake disability. I am all for helping someone who is disabled, you see, of course. A war veteran, for example, or someone who was born. But there is so much faking of medical sickness in the West because the incentives are wrong. So our system put the incentive right, but we have not yet solved the full problem. Yes? I saw a hand there. Yes? And then Corinne. I'm still at 12:30, yes? I'm okay? 12:30, I understand the problem. Yeah.
As far as I know,
more love.
As far as I know, Chile has one of the largest income gaps in the OECD. Inequality gaps in the OECD. Do you view this as a negative thing? And if you view this as a negative thing, you see what are the ways?
No, I don't view it as a negative thing. I view as a negative thing poverty. I don't view as a negative thing that if we have been able to grow at 7% and reduce poverty to 11%, and Bill Gates, as a Chilean, is very rich, and therefore each Bill Gates increase inequality. You understand that? So why should I see something wrong with Bill Gates?
Now that is I go further than someone yesterday. So I believe the whole inequality thing, as long as it comes in a free market economy and not inequality of the Russian oligarch, that is called fraud, stealing gap. So let me now, after having given you a provocative answer, go slowly, because this is a serious issue. There are inequalities and inequalities. The inequality that comes from privilege, from stealing, from corruption, from government protection, horrible. But it's not because of the inequalities, because of the way you get rich. But in a free market economy, if you get rich, or not rich, you get high income, because an engineer is rich in Chile. If you are high income because you have worked strongly, you have never stolen anything to anybody, and that because you can become rich because you are extremely good at what you do, a doctor, for example, doctors in Chile are all in that inequality gap. There's no problem whatsoever as long as you are not taking away from the poor. On the contrary, the successful entrepreneurs lift the people from poverty. So this whole OECD nonsense about inequality, the OECD at the end of the day is a Paris club of leftist economists. A lot of them my friends, you see. but you see, they have a little problem in France. So I am always amazed people, the OECD, they are tax-free bureaucrats in Paris, leftists, all of them, who support the welfare state that has France growing at 0%, unemployment in the Eurozone at 25%, and youth unemployment at 50%. So every time the OECD says something, they should put there a think tank that has obtained 25% unemployment in Europe. Now, where I am going. You have to choose basically your goals, your ethical, moral, political goals. I am someone 100%, 1,000% for elimination of poverty. I sacrificed a Harvard tenure to go to Chile. I sacrificed a Wall Street job to go to Chile to eliminate poverty. Not to help my friends, dentists, no, to eliminate poverty. So in that sense, I'm extremely progressive, if you want, because my great goal has been to eliminate poverty, freedom. But I do understand economics, thanks to Chicago and Harvard, maybe. And to eliminate poverty in a country like Chile, and probably in Israel, you have to grow at 7%, to put it fast. And when you grow at 7%, you need a lot of entrepreneurs, a lot of doctors, a lot of engineers, and those people make money in the market. So they get, quote unquote, rich. And therefore, the inequality, the so-called inequality, grows. Because the poor get out of poverty from here to here, but Bill Gates get from here to the roof. So we eliminate poverty and we increase the distance between the less poor and Bill Gates. Now you could say, of course, some of you may say, as my generally, I have an uncle who is a bishop of Chile, archbishop, so a prince of the church. So he says, okay, my dear nephew, but why don't we eliminate poverty and eliminate inequality? You see, they want everything at the same time. Because I say, regrettably, God created a world where people move by incentives. That's clear. And if you want people by incentives, you need incentive to grow. You need entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurs want to make money. Therefore, if you want to have growth and elimination of poverty, someone will go up. So if you eliminate the rich, you also multiply the poor. Can I repeat that? If you eliminate the rich, you multiply the poor. Visit Cuba, my friend. No rich people, well, except Fidel Castro, of course. But everyone extremely poor, young girls selling themselves in the streets to Spanish tourists. That is Cuba. Tens of thousands of young girls selling themselves in order to have $5
to feed their families. That is Cuba. So there is no rich people, no Bill Gates in Cuba. Nonsense. Now, having said that, I will give you more food for thought. I even contest, but now this is more an intellectual thing, but it may be interesting, that even people who care about inequality so much should care about inequality of consumption and not inequality of income. All these calculations, these Gini indexes and so on, are they compare income inequality. Income is what you make. But what anyone really takes out from the economic system is consumption. If Albert takes a bottle of wine, I cannot take the bottle of wine unless he shares it with me. But suppose that Albert has, so it's when he consumes a bottle of wine that he prevents someone else from consuming a bottle of wine. That's consumption. But if Albert makes money, consume the same bottle of wine as I do, and the rest of the money goes to the Friedberg Economic Institute or to the Maimonides, his income is much higher than mine, but we consume the same because he's putting the rest of his money, in this case in philanthropy, but he can put it in investment, it's the same, creating jobs. So really you should, if you, even those who worry about inequality should calculate a Gini index for only consumption. And there, some people have done it, the inequality is immensely less, not to mention in Chile, because people cannot consume so much difference, as I mentioned yesterday. In America, still, you know, the consumption Gini index in America is 20 points less than the income Gini. Meaning that George Soros cannot manage at the same, cannot drive 5 Mercedes at the same time, which is the problem of the rich. The rich can have 1 Mercedes, but not 2 at the same time. So there is a limit to consumption. Now, still in America, you have people you have Donald Trump, you see, who consumes, I don't know how, even hair, whatever, he consumes everything. But in our Latin countries, and here comes the Catholic tradition, even the elite doesn't consume much, because there is a sense of austerity or responsibility. In Chile, you don't see outrageous consumption. In Chile, my rich friends live in houses that are very similar to a professional. They don't dare to have, you see, a palace like they do in America. In America, they can have it. Nothing wrong with some of it, but it's a little too much. No, so if you were to calculate the Gini index of consumption in Chile, you will have enormous equality of consumption. Now, how do you see the equality of consumption? Well, I see that the airport, my friend, I travel. And I see the young people like you with iPhones better than mine. But I'm not, but better than Albert's. I bet that you have generally iPhones better than Albert. iPads better because you have the last, the iPad Air, with a lot of applications. And I'm seeing that how you dress quite well. You have nights and brand, and you love the brand. So I go in airports and I see enormous equality of consumption. Now, Donald Trump is not flying with us, but Donald Trump is an exception. But I see, you see, because honestly, that is something beautiful of this world, so cheer up. Sursum corda, we say Latin. Huh? People are consuming, see, food. Everyone has good food. We're not talking about the extremely poor, and I said already, but food. For example, in this room, we are equality in food. Agree? Dressing. Equality in dressing. Maybe I am underdressed near some of the ladies, very elegant. Appliances. Everyone has. That's why these young people of the Occupy Wall Street, all this movement with the latest iPhones, you see, complaining against Steve Jobs. Either ignorance or hypocrisy. So in almost every field there is extraordinary quality of consumption. Air travel, now with the internet, EasyJet, the young people in Europe for €40 move from Paris to Rome In the day, you can go for a cappuccino in Rome for 40 euros in EasyJet. As long as you work well the internet and five, maybe 10 euros, maybe zero. But people, anyone can go to Bali, Indonesia, you see the young people there. Without ink, they are not the sons of the rich. I am approaching the two difficult areas. Education. You say, yeah, but education. Today, you may have heard of education online. Harvard and MIT, the best two universities of the world, followed closely by Chicago, have created edX. edX gives online courses for free. You see, a foundation paid for me $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 for my Harvard education. Today you can get Harvard education for free. Now, okay, from Jerusalem, subsidized, I'm not sure it's fine. Harvard education for free from Jerusalem with your little iPad, you register, you have the same professor I had, you gave the test. Now you miss some of the networking, but you have other ways. So the world is going toward free online education. You can get the best of such, that is, if you are a young person really want to learn. There is the, imagine the equality of opportunity there vis-a-vis 50 years ago. See, today any young people in Chile can have the clothes. I agree, it's not exactly the same, but they can have the essence of a Harvard or MIT education online and for free. This is the democratization of education. This maybe is the most important revolution going on today in the world. And yet you only see the students, free education, marching in the street. That is all nonsense. The free education is here thanks to technology. Now, the only area where I am more concerned, yet for now, is health. In health, regrettably, it's still no anything closer to equality, because regrettably, doctors are very expensive, clinics are expensive. You cannot have a health operation online for free. Although they are approaching that, you Israelis have an incredible contribution in Tel Aviv. I will visit on Thursday. I want to know that. That is, you are developing microwaves, micro-miniaturization for health instruments. No, you are doing a great contribution toward democratizing healthcare. I have to recognize that still in health, you see, a high-income lawyer can get immensely better healthcare than the son of a worker. And we should work more on that, and that is a challenge because this is not heaven on earth. But equality of, so, excuse me, I took a little more, but this is a huge issue, you see. So you young people should not have any shame if you go into your careers and without hurting someone else, get good income. Because otherwise, all of you will be on the evil side of the inequality gap, you understand that? You are all of you are going to be in the 10% riches of Israel. So better study this, because otherwise you will walk in the street feeling shame. Because you who asked the question, I see your face, you are going for the 10% riches of Israel. No, because you are smart. You are already going to be in the 10%. Now my point is that there's nothing wrong, morally or politically or economically, as long as you don't get your money with fraud or you see stealing from someone else. But if you're going to be a professional, you were chosen to the Friedberg seminar by Bob Boris and Corinne, you are going to be in the 10%, if not the 1%. Okay.
Last question.
You had the last question, no?
Well, actually, you almost answered it. I wanted to know if poverty measure was an absolute.
If
it was poverty measure that you used in Chile was absolute or relative?
When you eat bread, it's absolute or relative?
No, but
let me use a little Socratic thing. If you eat a good food, and someone else is eating another food, your food is absolute or relative? That is your enjoyment of the food. Absolute, of course. Absolute poverty. Poverty is absolute.
No, because in Israel, we measure poverty
France. I am saying it's wrong to use it relatively.
Okay, so that's the way you...
No, it's poverty is absolute.
Okay.
Poverty is lack of the essential needs to feed your body, your mind is absolute. No, if you agree on the definition, that's why the statist and the wrong left they win a little the intellectual battle, because they put all these things relative, and then they will always be win, because there will always be differences. No, I know what you're saying, but I am making the case. No, but go for absolute. See, but people, you have to save people from poverty, from absolute poverty. You have to save the young girls from the street, from not selling their bodies in the street. Not compare them to Madonna. Madonna has her own life, a terrible life incident. I don't want any girl in the world to be in the street. That's absolute. So let's go for absolute. Let's eliminate absolute poverty from this world. Let's give everyone the opportunity of freedom of opportunity. Now, if there are also Madonnas and Steve Jobs and Gates are wealthy, don't care about them, don't read about them. Find your happiness in your own life as long as you do not have absolute poverty. Because with absolute poverty, what? So that is the goal. Forget these relevant things.
I'm asking for an exemption.
You always can have an exemption.
There is, in recent years, Israel found a lot of gas out of the sea. There's a tremendous amount of gas. But now there seems to be some renegotiation the government is trying to impose on the companies that found the gas. And there's a major dispute going on the rights and the taxes and so on. Can you tell maybe the crowd here that you're interested in that very nice anecdote that you had when you sold the mining gold? What was the problem and how you sold the mining? Do you remember that?
Yes, remember that. It's another subject, but of course, yes. They said, I mentioned them in passing. You see that Chile had this huge mining wealth, but a mining wealth hidden under the soil. My joke in Chile is that God is Chilean because he gave us that mining world, but God also plays trick with us and put it hidden so that our individual initiative, our entrepreneurship have to find it. So the huge issue with mining resources, and that can apply to gas and to oil, is that you need a legal system and a tax that has incentives to find the wealth. Because the wealth is not yours of your country if you do not find it. Now, it's completely reasonable for a country to say to someone, we will give you the right to explore, and if you find it, it is basically yours, but we impose a tax, a reasonable tax, because it was in our soil, blah, 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 blah. But once you put that in the law, you cannot change it afterwards, because you have to have the rules of the game. You know, good economists can discuss whether the tax should be this or that. That is an issue of tax competition around the world. There are some elements. But the key element is to respect the property right, because the property right is the incentive to explore. And exploring is an incredible difficult thing to find. So when I was explaining this to a lot of people in my country who didn't understand, they thought that the mines are there just to, like, they have this confusion with banana countries. Bananas are around. You look trees, you see a banana, you take it. Of course, there is no big deal. But oil and gas and copper are hidden, sometimes kilometers inside the sea. Or you need enormous capital. You need an enormous risk. There is a famous Brazilian that I know, a young man, Aike Batista, we met him once ago, who thought he had found all the oil of the world in Brazil and invested millions, and a lot of people put money, and all this was a 40 billion operation, and suddenly there was not so much oil, and everyone lost fortunes, and the private sector lost a fortune because they wanted also to hit it. So there are people who lost the money. So once someone discovered the oil and the gas. You cannot then say, ah, now you discover something that is very good, so we will change the rules, we will overtax you, because if you do that, then in the future, someone will not come to find other natural resources in your own country. So I am all for having a reasonable sharing of the results between the government and the private sector, but all set before in clear rules and at levels that promote this. So that's what we need in my country. It's the complete opposite of the country that I come. I come from France, where the president, François Hollande, and all his ministers are extremely proud in that nobody in France can even look for shale gas. They cannot exploit shale gas. C'est la France. They cannot even find shale gas. Exploration is prohibited in France of shale gas. The shale gas that is changing America in an incredible energy revolution. The shale gas that I hope will change in France, it is totally prohibited to. And instead of that, they get atomic energy, and still they have a minister for the environment. Incidentally, the former wife of François Hollande, Ségolène Royal. So it's all hypocrisy. You see, they are supposedly for the environment. They are the country with the highest atomic nuclear energy plants. They prohibit shale gas exploration. It's a terrible combination. So I'm so happy that Israel is moving in the direction of exploiting those resources, but I'm not aware of the exact problem that you are mentioning, and I hope you will teach me a little more later. So thank you so much. We see you tomorrow.